ಸಹನಾವವತು ಸಹನೌ ಭುನಕ್ತು ಸಹ ವೀರ್ಯಂ ಕರವಾವಹೈ ತೇಜಸ್ವಿನಾವಧೀತಮಸ್ತು ಮಾ ವಿದ್ವಿಷಾವಹೈ. ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿ. ಆಪ್ಯಾಯಂತು ಮಮಾಂಗಾನಿ ವಾಕ್ ಪ್ರಾಣಃ ಚಕ್ಷುಶ್ರೋತ್ರಮಥೋ ಯಾಣಿ ಚ ಸರ್ವಾಣಿ ಸರ್ವಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಉಪನಿಷದಂ ಮಾಹಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ನಿರಾಕುರ್ಯಾಂ ಮಾ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ನಿರಾಕರೋತ್. ನಿರಾಕರಣಮಸ್ತ್ವನಿರಾಕರಣಂ ಮೇ ಅಸ್ತು. ಧರ್ಮಾಃ ತೇ ಮಯಿ ಸಂತು ತೇ ಮಯಿ ಸಂತು. ಓಂ ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿ ಶಾಂತಿ. In a string of 5 mantras, the message given repeatedly is that the moment truth is put in the category of the known, it's no more the truth. Known through a description, by word, by speech, known through a conceptualization by the mind, known through the eyes, saying it has this color or that form, known through the ears, saying it is a sound of such kind. Known in any way. The moment we say the truth is of this kind, it's no more the truth. Very tricky situation. The moment you take a picture of the cat and show the photograph, look, here is the cat, everybody says that is not cat, that is a picture of the cat. This example is simple. However, in the matter of truth, all of us again and again slip and fall. There is the irresistible urge in us to own truth. Call it truth, call it love, call it goodness. With regard to all this, the human mind, the mind of you and me, has this tendency to own it. I know what it is to be good. I know what it is to love. I love him. He doesn't understand it. In this way, we own, in the act of owning, the very beautiful thing, truth, love, goodness, whatever, is lost. This is very profound. I will just make a couple of comments, then we go further. Very profound and very fascinating, inasmuch as you have a similar situation even in advanced physics. If you read, for example, there are a lot of books in that field, but if you read as an example Amit Goswami's book, Self-Aware Universe. It's a book on certain topics of physics. There he makes a very interesting proposition. He himself is a great physicist. You know, in physics, for those of you who have totally forgotten physics also, what I am going to say is pretty simple. There is the question, is an electron matter or energy? If it is matter, it is a particle located at a point. If it is energy, then it is a wave. A wave, on paper, we write as a graphic form, but it's a graph, meaning it is a spread of energy and constantly changing. More energy here, less here at this moment. Next moment, less there and more here. Wavy pattern. So it is an energy distribution, it's not a location. So there is this question in physics, is an electron a particle located at a specific point or a wave spread out, and a particle has mass and a wave has no mass, mass and energy. E equals mc squared, etc. Some of you may remember, energy and E is energy, m is mass. They have a relation. But energy is not matter, matter is not energy. We have all these basics, and representing the research of modern day physicists, this author Goswami says, whatever it is, matter or energy, suppose it is observed by a conscious observer, then whatever it is collapses into particle, he says. Why am I using an expression whatever it is? Because we don't know what it is. We don't know whether it is matter or energy. So therefore this expression whatever it is used knowingly, not just like that. Because some people use whatever just like that. Whatever it is, you know, let us do whatever we have to do. They use such language. If you ask them, what do you mean? Whatever I mean, how does it matter to you? In such cases, people use such a language out of carelessness. They don't want to think and specify. Because to specify something, you need to think, and that is some expenditure of energy. So they don't want to think. Like the poor language of some people uses too many pronouns. And he then went and said to her, and then she told him, and then all of them were disturbed. Now, who is he? Who is she? You ask them, who is he here? He, you know, I told you it is he. Who is he? Her brother-in-law. But who is her here? They use too many pronouns. This is called lack of precision in language. So here we are not saying whatever it is for lack of precision. It is deliberate. We don't know whether this so-called electron is mass or energy. Whatever it is, a conscious observer sees it, and Goswami says it collapses into a particle. Very interesting language. And if the observer is not conscious, meaning a camera, you know, there are electron microscopes, there are varieties of instruments these days which can also take recordings. The scientist is sleeping at his home, but he has set up some equipment, and that equipment is recording. So next morning, after his morning breakfast maybe he comes and takes all the prints and all the graphs, whatever. Machines have. A machine is not conscious. Chetana nahi hai usme. Conscious means chetana yukt. And unconscious or not conscious means chetana rahit. And Goswami says if it's an unconscious or not conscious observer, the electron is seen to be waves. So is it waves? Is it a particle? He says we cannot give a single answer. And in the present context of these five mantras, an interesting semblance or resemblance could be, the moment you try to conceptualize, to try to give a shape to it, it is this way, then it ceases to be truth. Till then it is fine. Very delicate matter. Therefore, the Vedanta itself, as you are aware in Viveka Chudamani, Atma Bodha and so on, gives an analogy. This Atman Atma Viveka is like separating the very delicate core in a certain reed of grass called munja. The Sanskrit words used are munjat ishikam yatha pratyeki kuryat. You want to separate ishika. Ishika is the Sanskrit word for that very tender, very delicate central part of a reed of grass. If you go about it hurriedly, then not only the outer sheath, but the inner core also gets broken, gets spoiled, gets damaged. Very carefully you remove the outer sheath and take the inner ishika. So this example is given for Atma and Atma Viveka. So in the matter of you and me knowing Brahma, which in the Advaita outlook is same as the Atma, therefore you may say in knowing the Atma, if we are a bit careless, then everything is gone. Then the last part of the each of the five mantras would apply. Nedam, that's not Brahman, you missed it. Nedam, na idam, na idam. If you want the first part to apply to your search, then maximum care needs to be taken. So going back to the first analogy I gave, the moment you take a picture and start worshipping the picture, you have lost the truth. What you therefore need to do is don't take pictures at all. Enjoy the stream, the sight of the stream, the sound of the stream, sit on a little rock by the stream and be in that ecstasy. Once you start taking pictures of the stream, video recording, audio recording, you fret and fume, in between battery is low, in between memory is full, in between suddenly the sun is blocked by clouds. These photographers, these cameramen, or all of us, you know, in many an excursion this happens. Finally, all of us do feel we should not have brought this at all. This camera, this laptop, this mobile, this gadget, ye sab laake hamara pura trip kharab ho gaya. And all of us plan many times, I will come again, that never happens. Come again purely for meditation. This is such a beautiful place. I will come again just to sit and sing, lose myself in gay abandon and so on. But do we ever do that? Always our calculative mind, our business mind always says, we are going so far, take this camera, we'll take a few pictures, take that video and do this and do that. So we start scheming, we want to maximize what we draw from that picnic. But how it turns counterproductive? In a manner of saying, a developed country like United States of America has terribly floundered, has erred in the same way to maximize, you know, standard of living and to maximize the so-called happy living. They have made their life so sophisticated, so much ruled by machines, so much ruled by systems. No doubt they are affluent, but everybody knows there is so much of stress and so much of loneliness. Either you are stressed or you are very lonely. And lot of sorrow there is. There is no true fulfillment. And on top of it, they mess up Iraq, they messed up Vietnam before, they mess up the whole world also. They are messed up and then they mess up rest of the world. But in a very impressive way. When America messes up something in the world, you know, all of us say, wow, this is so impressive. But what is the use of being impressive? A mess is a mess, whether done efficiently. Therefore, Gurudev Chinmayananji long back joked, rich are comfortably unhappy. We poor people in developing countries are uncomfortably unhappy, maybe. They are comfortably unhappy. Who cares for their comfort? They are unhappy. What went wrong? See, it's the same problem. Here in the Upanishads, the issue is handled in a very subtle context. And the psychological mess of developed countries, of a rich businessman, of a learned professor in university, etc., are no different from this problem. Why? The nature of the problem is, the human being is unable to let go of his own creation. He creates a picture, gets stuck in it. He creates a poem, gets stuck in it. He creates a drawing, gets stuck in it. In every act of ours, having brought out the act, if we could just release it, like releasing a pigeon to freedom, then it's so beautiful. But we don't release anything. We act, then we hold it to take more mileage out of it. Taking photograph, recording something, investing, brooding over the returns of investments, our life has become like that. And in all these, it's not easy to maintain inner balance. That intelligent, apparently intelligent act holds us captive. We are hijacked by it. Therefore, what is that expression? Frankenstein's monster. The scientist Frankenstein produces a monster, and the monster goes after Frankenstein himself. Shiva gives a blessing to Bhasmasura that whatever he touches turns to ashes, and Bhasmasura goes behind Shiva. Here, of course, as sheer sport, Shiva runs then. Bachao, bachao. sport, of course, leela. But you and I are not able to do any such leela. When what we create comes after us, we are really in great sorrow. Unless in a Vedantic sense, yes, that is also a leela. Because really nothing can happen to us. But do we know it? If we know that nothing can happen to us, then we too could be like Shiva. In other words, there is Shiva in us too. Nothing can happen to us. But we don't have that knowledge and we suffer. So this na pranena praniyate or yena prana praniyate, na pranena praniti. That na in every mantra, na shrotrena shranoti, na chakshusha pashyati, na vacha abhyudhyate, na shrotrena shrutam. This, all the five mantras have a negation first. It cannot be heard by ears, it cannot be said by speech, it cannot be seen with eyes, and so on. What does it mean? The moment you try to see or hear or describe, you have slipped and fallen. The moment a conscious observer sees whatever it is, it becomes a particle. You don't know what it is actually. And the upshot, the practical upshot of all this is, the truly wise person stays in openness, because hearing, seeing, touching, describing is all, as I use the word, a sort of capturing. You capture it, it is gone. Don't capture. Be in touch with whatever it is, be that yourself and stay open. You capture the parrot, put it in a gold cage. The charm of the real parrot is gone. The real parrot, free and flying, chirping, jumping from one tree to another, flying from one tree to another and so on. Is that charm available inside the cage? So the moment you capture, whatever you captured is no more whatever it was. So what is reality by itself? We would know only when we do not capture. Do not try to hold it. Don't hold it. Experience it just like that. In trying to capture, you create a duality and truth is lost. When you do not capture, the undivided truth just is. Without a word uttered, you then experience it, enjoy it, without storing it in your mind, without pigeonholing it. Pigeonholing is, you put it here. Now it belongs here and so on. The moment you pigeonhole it, you lose it. So, this is the simple basic message here. You are that and do not try to freeze it in any fashion. But there is an unrest in us. All said and done, we again want to do something. You see, sitting quiet is the most difficult thing in our life. Extremely hard. Something or the other rises in our mind. Some memories rise. Even if you go to Himalayas intending to be a recluse, you will not succeed. Go to the jungles, you will not succeed. Either tremendous laziness will come over you, or you get frustrated there, you get agitated there, in some other ways. For the real difficulty is within. Therefore, majority of students, after years and years of study of Vedanta, cannot really claim to have understood the Vedanta. Accordingly, in the next section, the guru of this Kena Upanishad, probably addressing a whole class, and maybe facing a particular student, says, after all that I have said, it looks like you have not understood it. So this is a very puzzling mantra here. The guru taunts a certain disciple, provokes a certain disciple. So we shall see now how he provokes and how that student responds to that provocation. In part 2 we have Yadi manyase suvedeti.
Dabhramevapi nunam tvam vetha. Brahmano rupam. Yadasya tvam yadasya deveshu. Athanu mimamsya mevate. Manye viditam.
There is no rigid rule how to chant, where to stop. I have paused by my own choice. This one is not so much metrical. Therefore, we have gone by our own style. So we have here the guru speaking. Yadi manyase. Yadi means if. If you think, manyase is think. If you think, suveda. See, veda means I know. And suveda means I know it precisely. I know it now, left and right. I know it thoroughly. Su stands for very well. The guru says, if you think you know very well, I tell you, dabhram eva. Dabhram means very little. If you say you know very well, I would retort, you know very little, which means you don't know. You hardly know. In Hindi you have this todehi. Aap todehi jante ho. Todehi literally I think is little. But the usage of that is that you do not know. Or for that matter, in English language also, you know little without the article A. When they say you know little, it means you don't know. Few people came there, means hardly anyone, no one came, without the article A. You have similar expressions in all languages. Here also, dabhram literally means little, but what it implies is you don't know. If you say you know, I tell you, you do not know. You do not know the true nature of Brahman, either in yourself or even in gods. The Brahma pervades the whole universe. Brahma is in you, Brahma is in me, Brahma is in gods, Indra, Varuna and so on. Brahma is in an elephant as well as in a little ant. I believe Satya Sai Baba in one of his discourses said, I am God. Somebody who had come first time to Puttaparthi liked everything in Puttaparthi. Everything was so clean, so neat. We are so happy with this ashram, for example. It is so beautiful. And Puttaparthi is something like this multiplied by 10,000. Because over the years, Satya Sai Baba has developed a huge ashram with a lot of beautiful things, not just physical things, lot of seva, shramadan, providing water to many villages around, health, medical care, and bhajan, kirtan, discourses. Every day it is a festival there. So this man was very impressed. This visitor was very happy. But when he heard Satya Sai saying, "I am God," he felt a bit uneasy. Maybe he was not much exposed to Advaita Vedanta also in the first place. But otherwise also he felt that this is jarring. We generally expect Babaji's, Mahatmas, holy men to be very humble. And this Swami suddenly said, he is himself God. So this man later asked, he got a chance to talk to Satya Sai. "Swami, I was very happy with everything, but you said you are God and somehow it did not go well with me." And Satya Sai smiled and said to him, "That should not bother you. What I meant was, I am God and you too are God." The message here is, you too are God. There is God only. Nothing else exists. Then that visitor understood that, oh, this has some wider meaning. This "I am God" of Advaita Vedanta is not to be hastily understood. So when the Rishi of the Advaita Vedanta says, "I am God," there is no reference to his personality. This man, this individual, alone is God and others are not God. No. It is the negation of individuality, negation of any plurality, negation of any duality. It's like a wave saying, "I am water." When a wave says, "I am water," right away the discovery implies all waves are water. So in that setting the guru says, "You don't seem to know the divinity within you, nor do you seem to know the divinity anywhere else, such as Deveshu. Therefore, your understanding is very questionable." Mimamsyam. Mimamsyam means something that needs to be again inquired into. Mimamsa literally means the need to measure. Ma means to measure. Mana, pramana, parimana, you have these words. Ma mimite means to measure. And mimamsyam with a duplication in the grammar, you know, mi, mimi, mima, like that, that is called duplication. It has the sense of check again. Don't measure once, measure again. Double check. So your knowledge deserves to be, ought to be double checked. And in the context, as we shall see in the next mantra, this particular disciple had not misunderstood any of the teachings. This particular disciple to whom the guru says this has not misunderstood. He has understood very well. Therefore, we said the guru is provoking the disciple. In the shastras, there is some nyaya. Nyaya means a maxim. And that is about, you know, you want to fix a pole in the ground. So you make a little hole and put the pole there, then fill it up, put some big stones, small stones, and a little of sand and hit it well. After all that, we have all done this. We want to finally check whether the pole is properly fixed. We hold it and try to shake it a little bit. That time if somebody comes and asks, I thought you wanted to fix it firmly, now you yourself are shaking it. Then you say, I am just checking. So the Guru saying, I don't think you know well, is actually to check whether this disciple has truly understood. So mimamsyameva, and the Guru looks at the disciple's face. The disciple for a moment is shaken. The disciple ponders, why is my Guru saying like this? And after a little pondering, the disciple understands, oh, the Guru is double checking, he is teasing, in other words. He is in a sportive mood, jovial mood. He seems to just have some fun with me. Therefore, this disciple responds in a sportive mood itself. He reciprocates the sentiment of the Guru. So first he says, as this mantra itself, where the print has put a comma, after the comma, softly he says, Manye viditam. I think I know. And meanwhile, his intellect works more. Have I concluded? Have I frozen the picture of Brahman? I have not. I have followed the Guru's instructions and I have actually let go of all images, including the image that I have let go. See, that could also be another image. Adi Shankaracharya in his Gita Bhashya says, a certain sadhu sits below a tree in a jungle and he has given up his home, his family, his wealth, his everything, and has come to the jungle and sits and has a tiny thought. Yes, now I have given up everything. And Shankaracharya says, if the sadhu has even a tiny thought that I have given up everything, then he has not given up. Because though he has given up his wealth, his family, his position and possessions and so on, he has not given up the thought that he has given up. So in the Gita, 4th chapter, there is the shloka, Karmani akarma yappasyet, akarmani cha karmayaha. In life, we need to be so sharp, we need to sometimes seek action in what seems to be inaction. And also at other places, we need to see inaction in what seems to be action. So for the first part, to see action in what appears as inaction, Adi Shankara gives this example. The sadhu is apparently in akarma. He has given up all his karma. But that one thought, I have given up. Other fellows tried but they could not. Other fellows, you know, halfway went back. I gave up. Like one of us suppose says, you know, I found out that ego is the problem. So, I gave up all my ego. In fact, I am the only person who gave up ego. Everybody else is so egoistic. You know that, no? No? What a funny thing it is. The man who has given up ego would not say, I have given up ego, right? So, that is a subtle, tricky thing there. So, here this disciple, when humbly, when softly first he responds softly, Manye viditam. His intelligence is operational, it is working. It seems when in England, J. Krishnamurti once conducted some kind of retreat, some newcomer came And the newcomer saw that there were discourses, there were dialogues, group discussions, and a huge tent or something had been put, facilities, like here we have, you know, nice facilities, good food, this and that. And on the third day, the visitor said to J. Krishnamurti, "I tell you, you got a good thing going on here." Going on or going? Going, I think, is better. You got a good thing going here. That was a slight taunt. You have become a nice guru and now people are taking care of you. All you need to do is give some talks. High stuff bol do. Sab ho gaya. So the visitor, not in a rude way, but in a gentle way, he made a taunt actually. "You got a good thing going here." And Krishnamurti heard that and kept quiet. In another later lecture, he referred, "Yesterday that visitor made this comment, and you know, that instant itself, I started watching myself even more alertly, and I watch myself like a hawk." This is the expression he said, like a hawk. Because to talk about watching is one thing, but does the man, Krishnamurti or any of us, do we actually watch? The tiniest waves of advantage, privilege, some position, some name, fame, or when we don't get them, the tiniest wave of hurt and despair and they got it, I didn't get it, and so on. These are all the smell of the ego, right? So I would say this disciple was like that. When the guru provoked him, anyhow he was living an alert life, and it was as though he became even extra watchful. Is there in me a conceptualization? Is there in me a consolidation of my position? These are all good words in the corporate world. Consolidate your benefits, your profits and your, you know, assets. Consolidation. But in the higher Vedanta, that is a bad word, so to say. Because from the higher point of view, why do you have to consolidate anything when you yourself are Brahman, right? So is the case with the science of awareness. When you are able to stay as pure awareness, you don't have to consolidate and secure anything. You don't have to keep any backup. You don't have to keep some kind of, you know, what they call it, plan two. I am doing self-inquiry, but as a plan two, I do some other sadhana. Most of us do that because we are so shaky. Now you may appreciate why someone like Krishnamurti, when you read his literature, he apparently comes down heavily on any worship, any japa, any puja, you know, any technique. You would understand now, because his clarity is like that. When you are watchful, it is complete in itself. And I told you other day also, in Shankara Bhashyas also, karma khandana, karma jnana samuchaya khandana is there. When the samyak darshana is with you, you have samyak darshana, then agnihotra, that is the old example, daily agnihotra. In modern times, some other sadhanas. But then, does it mean you don't do yogasana? I think I quoted, was it here or in yesterday's question answer I quoted. Krishnamurti did yogasana every morning for 4 decades. But in that very thought-provoking statement he said, "I have been doing yoga for 40 years, but I never allowed it to become a habit." That means, when he did yoga, there was not a tiny thought about it, that this will help me live longer, this will help me keep fit so that I don't have to depend on anybody. See, you and I also don't want to depend on others. But to clarify, when we say we don't want to depend on others, there are two components there. One is our concern for others, you know, they should not suffer. But other is our abhimana. This concern is understandable. But suppose you and I do yoga, or you and I take care about food, you and I do so many things to keep up our health, and there is a fear in us that unless I do this, I will have to depend on others, and it hurts my pride. Like in a certain house, I noticed the mother-in-law and daughter-in-law were not going along well. Okay. And the mother-in-law was afraid of falling sick. You know why? She was afraid of falling sick because if I fall sick, I have to take help from this human. I hate to take even a glass of water from her. That kind of thinking. This is what we call psychological mess. When we have likes and dislikes, we hate to take help from X or Y, or we very much want to take help from A or B in the field of likes and dislikes. So when Krishnamurti says, I didn't make it a habit, what it has all these implications. He would do his yogasana, or he would chant Purusha Sukta. Yesterday our Maharaj Sahib said he was occasionally chanting Shiva Mahimna Stotra also. He would listen to classical music. He would invite Palghat Mani, who is a mridangist, is it? Some well-known instrumentalists to Rishi Valley, host them for 2-3 months and say that, please teach these children, and some evenings you play the mridanga. Apparently he did so many things, but in all of them there was no attempt either to consolidate things or that mechanical, you know, way of, all this have to be done, then only my place will be a nice place. Some kind of notion. Because you see, any other place has this, so let our place also have it. This is what makes many of our actions in daily life mechanical. At another place they asked him, why do you do yoga every day? He said, it's like combing the hair. Generally, you know, if you compare yoga with combing hair, it would be some kind of an insult. Combing hair is considered a, you know, very ordinary act, a daily chore. But here it comes out in a different sense. In what way? People do yoga, or for that matter any other fitness exercises, with some hope, with some desire for future. In him, there was no desire for future. It was just an appreciation of beauty, appreciation of aesthetics. You know, we comb our hair for either it looks disheveled and it doesn't look good, so we just set it right and go. So it's a simple affair. So he made yoga such a simple affair in the sense, it's the right way of living, that's all. There is no investing in, you know, emotions about future. Investing emotionally means in the process suffering some fear, suffering some hope. Right? Whenever my mind is messed up, in psychological mess, when we give something to somebody, the calculative mind starts working. I have given her and this will have good returns in due course of time. So that is sakama, you know, sakama karma. So yogasana also could become a sakama karma. All mechanical activity, all habits have the sakamatva. Either they are tamasic, just dull, or rajasic, where kama is clearly smelled. You can smell kama. Kama is desire. So, we can see this when he softly says manye viditam, this student is watching like a hawk. Is there the tiniest wave of consolidating, ensuring something for future? No. I have given up and there is no thought that I have given up also. That also has disappeared. I just am. There is only awareness here. I have nothing to take or give from anybody or to anybody. Without verbalizing, without saying these words, the student becomes clear on this. Because verbalizing is unnecessary. When you know it, you know it. When you know that you are free of desire, you just know. You don't have to say to yourself, you don't have to say to anybody. So, manye viditam is a quiet, non-verbal recognition within and its expression. And then, I said, he also becomes sportive. So, like a sport, like in a ping pong, you put the ball back. Ball comes to you, you put it that side. The teacher again puts the ball in your court, the student again puts the ball in teacher's court. That is sport. So the ping pong goes on now. In the second mantra of this part 2, the student also answers in the same language. And this is a very, very off-quoted mantra. Naham manye suvedeti. No na vedeti veda cha. Yo nastad veda tad veda. No na vedeti veda cha. Naham manye suvedeti. No na vedeti veda cha. Yo nastad veda tad veda. No na vedeti veda cha. This is what the student says. The teacher had said, yadi manyase suveda iti. If you think you know it very well. The student, with a smile on his face, humbly says, I do not claim that I know it very well. So this is as though he accepts defeat. Yes, sir, I don't know. But not with a full stop, with only a comma, he springs back and says, that does not mean that I do not know. No, na veda. I don't say I know it. This doesn't mean I do not know it. Nor do I claim that I know it. But be sure, you cannot say I do not know it. Oh, he is swinging back and forth. Just as yesterday we talked, bigger than the biggest, smaller than the smallest. If the guru were to ask the student, so finally what is your understanding? Student also were to say to the guru, yes, it is bigger than the biggest. What? Student says, I mean, it is smaller than the smallest. What did you say? I say it is very big. The guru says, tell me again. Sir, it's very small. So, just as Guru talked earlier in an apparently contradictory language, the student also uses the same language. This doesn't mean that when any of us starts talking nonsensically, we are wise. It is said Newton in his school days did not listen to the teachers. He wrote some diagrams on the wall. Somewhere in England, I believe that school is still kept in shape, where Newton studied. Later he became the famous scientist. Does it mean that any of us who also write some crow, some sparrow and some drawings on the walls of our classroom would also become like Newton? So to talk in some puzzling manner doesn't make one wise. But very often, not always, wise people speak in very puzzling language. In Saddarshana, Ramana Maharshi says, we are nowhere in time and nowhere in space, but you know, we are everywhere in time and everywhere in space. Na kvapi bhamo, na kadapi bhamaha, vayam tu sarvatra sadacha bhamaha. Na kvapi bhamaha means we don't appear at any time. Na kadapi bhamaha, we don't appear at any time, the earlier was place. You cannot see us at any place, you cannot see us at any time. But the same shloka in its last line says, fourth quarter, vayam tu sarvatra sadacha bhamaha. You could find us everywhere, you could find us at any time. And the first half of that shloka makes the clarification. Suppose we are the body, then a sense of limitation, location. Location in space, location in time would apply. Dikkala leela iha vapur vayam chet. If we are vapuhu, if we are the body, then dikkala katha. All talk about, where will you be March 14th? Oh, Kolkata. Aha. Okay. So, March 14th is a point in time. Kolkata is a point in space. So, you are located there. X, Y, Z is coordinates of space. Kolkata is in X, Y, Z. T for time is the coordinate, the axis of time. March 14 is a point in that axis. So, when you look at yourself as the body, you could answer, I am in Kolkata on March 14th. But when you look at yourself, it's all how you look at yourself. When you look at yourself as pure awareness, vayam tu sarvatra sadacha bhamaha. I am everywhere, I am at all time. So looks very puzzling, but very true. So the Rishi, now the disciple who is also a Rishi in his own right now, gives all these apparently contradictory answers. I know, I do not know. Please do not imagine I do not know, but I never said I know. Such looks like some kind of blabbering, but it is not. Not only the disciple claims this kind of position with respect to whether he knows truth or not, but he also extends it to other people in his class. He says, naha, in second line. Among us, in this class, anyone, let us say, were to have the same insight as this one has now, then with respect to them also, it would apply in the same way. What's that? So he repeats, no na vedeti vedacha. Na veda, I do not know. Veda, I know. So both of them apply. They also know and they also do not know, and so on and so forth. So what does it mean? If it is a matter of knowing Brahma through attributes, then we don't know Brahma through attributes. And if it is a matter of knowing Brahma without attributes, guna, upadi, lakshana, varnana, description, or other language we employed a while ago was, there are two things, knowing Brahma, attributing an image to it, and knowing Brahma with no image attached to it. So if it is the second kind, then I know it. If it is the first kind, then I don't claim, because that is no true knowledge at all. Wo sahi gyan hai hi nahi. In these two mantras thus, what happens is a double checking, and the guru becomes very pleased. So the disciple smiles, the guru also smiles. Verification is over. Guru and disciple smile, and maybe one or two others also in the class smile, but many others wonder why they are smiling. Many others think that it is going a little beyond maryada. Somehow this guru and this student, they are having something special between them. Or whatever other way, others are disturbed. And among the others in that classroom, there is one brilliant fellow about whom we will know at the end of this Upanishad. At the end he says, the guru says, the class is over. The disciple says, but teach us the Upanishad. There is a line, Upanishadam bo bruhi. There is one line, wonderful student he is. Like in all our towns and villages, you have that, you know, after hearing the whole Ramayana, a man got up and said, just tell me one thing. It was beautiful. Thank you very much. It was just marvelous, you know. But one thing is not clear to us. What is Sita's relation to Rama? Whole Ramayana sunkar, Sita ka Ram se kya sambandh hai? Ye jo poochte hain, unki mahima ka kya batai? What shall we say about their glory? So this classroom in this Kena Upanishad apparently had one or two of that caliber also. Whereas the present student got it right so fast. He is an Uttama Adhikari. See, among us also some of us are Madhyama Adhikari, some are Manda Adhikari, some are Uttama Adhikari. Variety is the spice of life. It is God's will. It is God's will that there be so much variety. God said, let there be light, and there was light. God said, let there be sound, there was sound. And then God must have said many more things not recorded in the books. God said, let there be mandamatis, and there were mandamatis. God said, let there be vidwans, there were vidwans. He created such endless variety. God only created those jihadis, or kya? Ati mandamatis, and set them on the move. God only makes Duryodhan act the way he did, Yudhishthir act the way he did. It is all a grand play, a sport of God. So this was an Uttama Adhikari. And then the Upanishad continues, or as Sarvananji says, translates, the preceptor, that is the guru, very pleased with the response of the student, now addresses perhaps the whole class and makes this comment. And this perhaps is even more quoted on many platforms than the earlier one.
Yasya matam tasya matam. Matam yasya na vedasaha, avijnatam vijanatam, vijnatam avijanatam yasya matam tasya matam matam yasya na vedasaha avijnatam vijanatam vijnatam avijanatam.
When we read it hastily, this is one more mantra which seems to be just self-contradictory. For take the first quarter, yasya amatam tasya matam. The word or the root man is in the sense of knowing. Somewhere else it could be in the sense of thinking, but here it is knowing. Or it is both. One of them is to be taken as conceive, think. Another is to be considered as knowing. But as far as the verbal root is concerned, it's the same. Yasya amatam tasya matam. And yasya matam saha na veda. That is the second quarter. Take the first quarter only. Yasya amatam, he to whom it is amata, we would say to him or to her it is mata. So what is this? How can amata become mata or mata become amata? As the English translation gives, with a little liberty of use of words. Otherwise, you know, strict translation could have been, he knows it who does not know it. Use the same word. But that is where Sarvananji has made it a bit easier for us. He carefully says, he understands it who conceives it not. Conceiving is conceptualizing. I know, it is like this. So, where thought interferes. In Krishnamurti literature, extensively there is this expression. Thought comes in, thought comes along, thought interferes. Thought then takes over. He used the word thought. In Ramana literature, it is the I thought, I hyphen thought. The I thought comes and sab kuch bigad deta hai. Sab kuch bigadne wala I thought hai. In Krishnaji literature, it is thought. For years I had difficulty with that. I said, why is he saying thought? Why doesn't he specify a kind of thought? Because all thoughts are not problematic. But slowly I understood that he has at some places clarified. Functional thoughts have a place in life. Functional means, you know, objective matters, objective affairs, where there is no self-judgment, where it is utterly related to something to be done. Somebody is hungry and I think, oh, he is hungry, let me get some food. This is thought. This thought is necessary. It's harmless. And if I were to not have such thoughts, I would be useless. Life would grind to a halt. So here and there he has clarified. And slowly I came to peace with his language, because then I reflected. In fact, everywhere in all subjects we do that. We generate certain technical words. And later on, we don't every time explain the word. Somewhere it has been defined. You see the definition of it. And then you just go ahead. For example, if offhand I may give an example of, you know, electronic engineering. The first chapter may use the word radio receiver. And afterwards, second page, third chapter, you just say receiver. So somebody takes up fifth chapter of a book on electronic engineer, there is a drawing, transmitter, receiver, and grinds his teeth. What book is this? Why don't they clarify that this transmitter is a transmitter of radio waves? And they should write here, receiver means radio wave receiver. So sare book likhte rahenge kya? Generally we don't do that. In the first chapter, there is something about radio receiver. And maybe there's a description also. Second chapter they write only receiver. In fact, in the third chapter, fourth chapter, when there is some discussion, they don't even write receiver. They will write RX and TX. One dibba dikhaya jata hai, RX and TX. And then, you know, that we do it everywhere. I'm sure in music, in dance, symbols are used. Initially you elaborate. Later on, you just use one word, and those who are studying it know that this word stands for that particular. So, Krishnamurti literature has its own terminology, thought. So, thought interferes. I know, and then thought comes in and says, aha, I know. Brahman is like that. So, description came in. Thought is out of memory. Thought is out of, you know, a store of accumulated information. Thought in this context is the response of a collection of experiences, hurt. I talked of the mother-in-law who hates to take even a glass of water from daughter-in-law. Why? Let's say the daughter-in-law is bringing a glass of water. The perception is this young lady is bringing water. But thought comes in. She is the one who criticized me with neighbors, that my mother-in-law doesn't know how to do this or that. You know? Memory. She is the one, she is the one, she is the one. Memories come. So that is called thought. And then though you are dying out of thirst, you say, who wanted water? Sunti bhi nahi aajkal. Humne paani nahi manga tha. Kisko paani chahiye? Fenko usko khidki se. Like that, you should daunted. Not daunted, what you call it? Daunt diya. So, it's that mother-in-law. You know which mother-in-law I am talking of? I should clarify. I am talking of that mother-in-law who is in every one of us. Every one of us is that mother-in-law. Even the men among us are mothers-in-law. In the sense, we are talking of a mind that operates with clouding, with that interference of memories. Our abhiman has been hurt somewhere. Our pride, right? Something went wrong long ago. Maybe yesterday or maybe 10 years ago. No problem. So, the mind is operating with an ounce of present perception, but pounds and pounds of the past emotional disturbances. So, in Krishnamurti literature, the definition of thought is response of memory, according to him. If you see a flower and say, ah, this is a beautiful flower, that is not counted by him. For it is true, most often within 2 seconds some memories rise. When I was in college, I used to take part in extempore, you know, and it used to be called pick and speak. I think now also they play. A box would be kept and you go and pick a piece of paper. There would be some subject. My memory is operating now. But I am trying to illustrate memories. So, I used to win prizes. That's how later on I became a speaker of Vedanta. The momentum. One day Chinmayananji said, why do you want to talk about all those things? Come here. Talk about Gita. So, I said, okay. TK, pick and speak. Extempore. Ashubhashana spardha, they call it. That means, there are two kinds, but in our college it used to be, you get 3 minutes. You take this piece of paper, you sit there, and the person who picked up before, 3 minutes before, he is talking. That time you think, what shall I say about this? And sometimes the other fellow goes blank, in 1 minute he gets down. Then you have to go immediately. And some other time he goes and goes. And one friend of mine, John Fernandez, his name, he got once the topic rose. You know, and he said, rose is a beautiful flower. Then I tell you, he went totally off the mark. He said, I offered a rose to a beautiful girl in that junior class. And college boys and girls, you know, all of them, then what happened? And really this happened, this John, I tell you, he began with rose is a beautiful flower. Then he said, I offered to this junior class ladki ko maine gulab diya. Then she did not accept it. And then he started telling about girls, about boys, about... he was not talking about rose at all. But phir bhi, the relevant aspect of it is, see, we all are supposed to talk for 3 minutes only, not more, because there are many others. He spoke for something like 12 minutes. This Mangalore boy, he had a gift of the gab. And he talked totally irrelevant stuff. Oh, it was not about rose at all. His memory went up. And all of us, I don't know whether I had spoken before or after. I was also one of the speakers that day, in the competitors. I remember some 300 of us were listening to him with rapt attention. Then one of the faculty teachers, he took that hammer and then he took the mic and said, John talked very well, no doubt, but I must tell you all, speakers should limit themselves to 3 minutes. And also he hardly talked about rose. There was such, you know, whole hall said, yes, but it was very interesting. How does it matter? He didn't talk about rose, but he talked about so many things which all the boys and girls also, you know, could identify with. How to handle a situation when the girl refuses. Phir kya karna hai? All these things. Wo gulab se aur kahin chala gaya. So no wonder Krishnamurti calls thought response of memory. It goes down the memory lane, and sometimes it is humorous, like we now described, but alas, more often than not, it is painful. Regrets, anger, and wanting to take revenge, teach a lesson, and so on. So thought comes in and hijacks you. Thought takes you away. Thought meaning memory, some response of memory. And how sad, in this Brahmajnana also, that is the culprit. Thought is the culprit. So just be. Don't try to put this beautiful, beautiful Brahman in the cage of thought, in the cage of concept. So he has said, who conceives it not? So if you do not conceive, if you do not put it in cage, then you know Brahma. The moment you put it in the cage of, in the pinjada of conceptualization, you lost it. So John Klein, about whom I made a reference, has one beautiful saying, perceive, do not conceive. Perceive is seeing what is. Not only a flower outside, but an anger inside you, or an abusive word somebody used at you. Perceive it. Somebody said, I know you very well, you are crooks for seven generations. Something like that he said. You not only you are a crook, I know you are khandan, saat peediyon se aap log aise hi hain. Sara gaon janta hai. Something he said. Perceive. But do not conceive. Conceiving means adding all kinds of other, especially as Ramana would clarify, revolving around I. This is not the first time he is saying. Last year, April 22nd also, he had insulted me. And in 2004 also he had done it. And I have heard that he does this, he talks ill of me in front of people, behind my back. This is called memories, you know. gathering more memories. That is conceiving. You hear this and not out of willpower, but out of the intelligence that sees the peril or the trouble with memories. By just willpower, if you say, I don't want to go back to memory, you feel so pulled, but somehow you hold back. It has limited value. Willpower always has limited value. It achieves many things in the world, but whatever it achieves afterwards has no value. So not out of willpower, I will not think of the past and so on, but out of a gentle operation of the intelligence, that going to the past, adding all sorts of things, heaping memories upon this perception, would only worsen the matters. So stay, like Vardhaman Mahavir in the video we saw, is depicted as perceiving quietly. No dullness at all. When we are dull, then also we don't react. After a few seconds, we say, kya kaha? Suna hi nahi. Wo baat nahi hai. Sunna chahiye. Hum pure sunte hain. Phir bhi, the memory is not recalled. We perceive, stay in a state of no reaction. Then the promise of the Vedanta, which also should appeal to our scientific spirit, is that something else comes up. When you, out of that intelligence, do not bring memory into picture, and there is apparently only perception, you may wonder, then what happens? We just perceive and stay like that? No. When the conditioned factors do not rise, from the depth of your heart, what is your true nature? Call it compassion, call it forgiveness, call it perception of right action. What actually needs to be done? Sometimes it can be a hard word also, because love is not always soft. Sometimes it is soft, sometimes it is hard, sometimes it is tough. So we don't rigidly describe the outer response. The response could be pleasant or unpleasant, but it comes from the source of true love. So you conceive not, you only perceive, and in that perception, something else takes over. Therefore it is that the sages, Buddha, Christ and so on, had silence apparently. That was one dimension of theirs, but another was shocking responses. Their responses would surprise everybody. Their responses were unpredictable. They would handle some situation with some kind of unusual solution. In the movie Mahatma Gandhi, Gandhi, somebody comes and says, the Mohammedans killed my, daughter, let us say. And a while ago, a Mohammedan girl had come. The Hindus killed my father. Something like that, yes. A girl comes and cries, mere baap ko Hinduo ne maar diya. Wo khadi hai udhar. And then, as fate would have it, a very angry man comes and, ye Muslim log, inhone, they killed my daughter. So this man has lost his daughter and this girl has lost her father. Gandhi perceives, and his past, he is a Hindu, he always acknowledged, I am a Hindu. My house has the foundation of Hinduism, but I have open windows, so the breeze of all religions freely go through my house. He gave this analogy. Right? So, but he did not let, not out of willpower, but there was so much of self-observation, there was so much of watching that had taken place in him, watching life, watching himself, watching things from a larger picture, larger angle of view, So, because of all that, the memories would not rise. I am a Hindu, or so there was no pro-Hindu or pro-Muslim tendency in him. Then he comes out with a very unique response. He very lovingly says to this Hindu father, "See, you lost your daughter, and this girl has lost her father. You adopt this girl." That is shocking. So violence is not followed by more violence. He is able to wrap up. Jo hua, ho hua. Ab hum log shanti se jiye. That kind of. We don't standardize, not that this has to be done in the same way. And Gandhi himself would not have planned it. See, the most beautiful actions in life don't come out of planning. The most beautiful ones come without planning, but when you have love in your heart, when you have peace, when you have samadarshana, equal vision, and you love everybody, then the solution, this particular solution to some particular situation comes up. So, matam yasya, if somebody is so much caught in thought, caught in conceptualization, caught in words, similes and metaphors, sometimes caught in language, saying, you know, whatever it is, truth is best described in this language only, Urdu or Sanskrit, Punjabi or, you know. Years ago when my Hindi was very weak, in Rewa, in Madhya Pradesh, I conducted a morning meditation class in English. My Hindi was not good enough those days. And one gentleman there, apparently very attached to, you know, mother tongue, Hindi and so on, very lovingly said to me over breakfast, "Brahmachari ji, aapne to English mein dhyan ka kaksha achha sambhala," something like that he said. But then he said to me, "Kintu, ध्यान ये अंग्रेजी का स्वभाव में नहीं है। ध्यान अंग्रेजी में ध्यान की कक्षा ये तो हो नहीं सकती." That was his prejudice actually. So I got very angry that time. Because we are divided over languages also. So why does he say this and all that? So it's like that. Some people think Urdu, some people, you know, every language, there are book. This is the book in which all solutions are given, they will say. Have you read any other book? Where is the need? Aapne padha hi nahi. Lekin is kitab mein, mere dadaji ne diya mujhko, is kitab mein जीवन के सब समस्याओं का समाधान है. In this way people say, that is all conceptualization. Upanishads would say, na vedasaha. So be happy about your language, your book, your whatever, but don't make the mistake of saying that this and this alone. Don't say Hinduism alone. Don't say Vedanta alone. What is true Vedanta? True Vedanta is not bound to any particular book. Vedanta is not a book. Vedanta is a wisdom. And this wisdom could appear in any form, any language. Vijanatam means those who say, "We know it." Of them, the Guru says, it is avijnatam. And avijanatam, in case of those people, like the second son of that father in the story we narrated yesterday, where the two sons went far to a jungle to Gurukula, came back after 12 years and so on. He was avijanatam. Do you know Brahman? Did they tell you? Did your guru teach you Brahman? All he does is put his head down. He belongs to this group of avijanatam. I don't know. I cannot say anything. About him it is said, vijnatam. See, we have ignorance. Then you and I learn a couple of languages, some social studies and maths, some science and biology, something. We run around in the world. We know a few people, we know a few places. We travel a little bit. With some knowledge, then we feel we know. First, we did not know anything. Then, apparently we know. But the Upanishads talk of a further stage where again, we don't know. So the circle is complete. They give the analogy. Somebody is here, he climbs the hill. The hill is the hill of knowledge. Then he climbs down on the other side. As far as elevation is concerned, he is back to the same level, same sea level. But what's the difference? Earlier he was on this side of the hill, now he has gone other side of the hill. Knowledge is like that hill. Some master has expressed it in yet another way. Before you gain Vedanta knowledge, he says, your mother is a mother to you, your sister is sister to you, your brother is brother to you. When you learn the Vedanta, you gather all knowledge of the scriptures, everything gets shaken. Sister is not sister, mother is not mother, brother is not brother. Because you have learned so many books, you wonder. Books tell you so many things. They will say everything is five elements. So you look at the sister and the packet of five elements coming towards me. Or any other way, it shakes up a lot of your notions. So sister is not a sister. Tejomaya Ananji once said, it must have happened really, when he was teaching students, one brahmachari after about 2 years of study, before going to some mission center to work, Swamiji told him, you go home 10 days, jaake maa baap se mil ke aao. Lekin ye sab Vedant padne ke baad my maa baap unko kaise dekhu? How shall I see my mother and father after all these studies? This fellow asked, it seems. I don't know whether Swamiji constructed this example or really it happened. Really bhi ho sakta hai. I told you, ek kaksha mein bahut chaturmati bhi hote hain. There are some brilliant boys who get such questions. And then he lovingly said, you know, when you go home, look at your mother as mother. And look at your father as your father. Look at your brother as your brother. Liklo, bhul jaoge. So with a lot of instructions, the brahmachari went home, met his family, then plunged into the field of prachar to liberate the world. So in this beautiful example it is said, before knowledge, mother is mother, father is father, but during the climb and when you are up the shikhar of knowledge, in that sense, everything gets shaken. But when you have completely gained knowledge or completely gained clarity, again mother is mother, father is father to you. Pehle jaise hi. Farak yahi hai ki raag dvesh nahi hai, mamata nahi hogi, shuddh prem, pure love. Otherwise you have attachments, aversions and all those things. So world becomes very normal. The world doesn't look something different, but some coloring that you are doing, some other kind of, you know, quoting, that goes away. Avijnatam vijanatam, vijnatam avijanatam. This is the Guru's words here. Is it a couple of minutes silently?